make sure I start this morning off right. Let's, all you guys, let's stand up and just give a hand of applause for our budget. We appreciate all you and for everything that you do. So thank you, thank you. We take a break this morning. We just started a new series called Conversations with God. It's really dealing with prayer and how to pray and so forth. We take a break for that today. Pastor Rick will start it up again next Sunday. And we pause to honor mothers. But in our series, I want you to continue the thought of what we're saying. We have a bed up here because we want to know, where does your prayer begin and where does your prayer end? And I couldn't think of a better place than where we get up of a morning and where we lay down for the night. So our prayer begins when our feet hit the floor and when our head hits the pillow at night. And so keep that thought this week, where does it begin and where does it end? But this morning we want to honor mothers. So I was thinking about the message to do to honor mothers. How can I honor mothers the best way? How can I shed light on God's word to mothers? I thought about how the message to preach, and I thought, no mother has walked in here this morning hoping that the pastor would preach on perfection, because the mother has so much coming her way. She's got everything together. Everything in her life is perfect. All her kids obey her in every step of the way. The rooms are always clean. Perfection's all around her. Her job is, her career's just launching. Her marriage is perfect. They're loving Dovey every day. There's not a crossword anyway. There's nothing. She's never befriended on Facebook. She's got it all together. She's just a perfect mother. And no one walked in, no mother walked in here this morning asking, well, I hope he preaches on perfection. I just need to know how to deal with it all. That never happened. And if you are one of those mothers that walked in here thinking that you are perfect and you have it all together, you are on crystal meth, and we need to find some way to get you off there. You need to quit that stuff. It's not healthy for you. Stop it. But I believe, you know, there's a lot of things. A lot of studies have went into how media, TV, radio, anything, online stuff, how it affects society. And one of the things that's been proven is a lot of times we want to imitate what we see and hear off TV. You know, the love songs, they just emulate the relationship I've always wanted. And movies the knight in shining armor kind of thing. Us men, we want to be that, you know? And the women, they just want to be everything that the princess is, you know? So it's proven that we oftentimes take away from the media some stinking thinking. And I wanted to bring a couple things to light here. Some of you might recognize this, but in 1957, we see what a mother, like a perfect mother, looks like, right? In an actress named Jean Cleaver. And off the show, Leave It to Beaver. I mean, this woman had it all together. Every time you saw her, everything was just right. Hair just right, pearls on, the dress was on. Even when she was cleaning the house, yeah. The pearls and the dress was on, and everything seemed immaculate. She had it all together. And here's another thing. In 30 minutes or less, any conflict was resolved. Now, and I don't know about you, but the world I live in, 30 minutes, we just reduced ourselves to name calling. It started to get personal. And in 30 minutes or less, they had it all figured out. And the worst thing part about it was, is if it said to be continued at the end of the show, you're a mess all week until the next show. Because you expected it to be resolved in 30 minutes. Well, maybe you don't relate to that one. Maybe you relate to another TV face, Claire Huxtable, in the Cosby Show. She seemed like she had it all together. I mean, she had a career, she was a lawyer, she was a mom, and it just seemed like every time you saw her, she had it all together. She was sassy and brassy and things worked out. And again, in 30 minutes or less, conflict was resolved. Everything was happy-go-lucky. And we walked away from the show saying, I can't wait till next week. And we sat down, established a time, watched it again. And it became part of our makeup, if you will. It became certain shows, now maybe not these two, but other shows became part of your makeup. And they affect you, right? So they put this perfect mother image out there, like these parents, these mothers have it all together. But there's not a mom in this room who feel like they have it all together, like these two ladies. But maybe there are people in this room who can relate to this next image. Marge Simpson. Now, her hair was crazy. She wanted to kill her kids. She wanted to kill her husband. And that was just all in one episode. It didn't include the week leading up to it. I mean, she was constantly wondering where she went wrong and what happened. She was constantly dealing with messes. Never happy. Listen, I mean, I can hear her in my head. I'm sorry. I think about things like this. Sorry, Mom. But moms in today's society, they don't feel perfect. They don't feel perfect. Moms, I need you to listen to me on this because the goal should not be perfection. It should be persistence.
Amen.
It's not striving to be perfect, but to stay persistence. And I'm not wanting to beat any moms down with the message today, but I want, as the message goes on, I want to give you some hope. Because it's tough. It's tough being a mom. Our message today comes from the Gospel of Luke. It's the third gospel in the New Testament. So if you turn to the New Testament, go three books into it, you'll find the Gospel of Luke. If you didn't bring your Bible with you, we'll have it here on the screen. But there's some unique things in the Gospel of Luke I want to look at today. Mothers, if you're struggling with fear, if you're struggling with doubt, anxiety, or what to do, where to go, who to turn to, what to say, what not to say, I want us to look at the mother of Jesus for specific reasons. I want you to know that Mary felt exactly the way you feel, that she struggled with doubt, she struggled with fear, she knows and is acquainted with the things that you struggle with today. Often, we departmentalize. Okay? We can be good in church, but we can't be good Monday through Saturday. That's departmentalizing. That's where we're at. You don't say that in church, but you say it Monday through Friday at work or at home or whatnot. So the same thing is true here. Sometimes when it comes to Bible stories, we want to departmentalize and say, well, that was then, this is now, we got new challenges now, and it don't apply. It does. The Bible is breathing and living, and it is dividing truth from lie every day. It is getting into the hearts and minds of the people who's willing to hear it. Don't departmentalize this. Mary is very comparable to you, mother. And I think we'll see that. But there are three words in your bulletin. You have a message handout. You can write those three words in there and then take some notes below there. But you have a message handout. Please take some notes there and write those words down. It helps get it into your mind. But there's some three words today I want to look at. And the first one is celebration. And as a mom, I believe you are the CCO when it comes to celebration. You are the chief celebrating officer of your family. You know how to celebrate a life. For instance, a lot of mothers, most mothers that I experienced, they like to celebrate the fact that they're expecting. They're pregnant. They're expecting. Now, sometimes, you come across women says, oh my, I'm pregnant. But for the most part, women find out that they're pregnant, they celebrate that. My mom likes to still celebrate my birthday. You know, I'm 41 years old, and she still likes to celebrate that and go out of her way and do things. You can see celebration on her face and her actions. She loves to celebrate, you know. But one of the things I love about social media is when they do birth announcements. You know, Facebook, they have a lot of things when they announce the birth. Well, this one family, you know, they already had a kid, but they put this birth announcement on Facebook. And sometimes that's how kids feel. Sometimes they feel like they're all blown out. But we love to celebrate. that God has a plan and purpose for the child, for children, or triplets, or, you know. But God knows. God's your creator. All mothers in here, God created you. And as a creator, He knows everything about you. And He put that instinct in you to know and nurture and support a God-given, life, purpose-driven life that's going to come from you and be supported thereafter. And mothers are the best at this. They stay at it. They stay with their children. They continue to be an encouragement with their children. No mother has ever come to me and said, you know, I think this child's life's going to suck. And it's going to be miserable. No one has said that. No mother said that. Why? Because that's not your nature. God did not make you to be that way or think that way. Mary had a birth announcement. She was getting informed that she was going to be pregnant. She was young. She had many challenges with this birth announcement. For one, it came from an angel, and God said He was going to impregnate her with His Spirit. Through the Spirit. And we see this in Luke chapter 1, as that's our focus this morning. Luke chapter 1, verses 31 through 33. The angel of the Lord told Mary, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. So that took the baby name question right out of it, right? Mary and Joseph didn't have to fight over that. God did it for them. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end.
Amen.
You know, so this is what Mary hears about the child she's going to deliver. So for the rest of her life, she knows God has called her to be a mother. That God has a plan and a purpose. That this ain't just some happening. And there's something special about this child. Just like every mother in this room knew that when they were pregnant, their child was special. Each and every one of them. Mothers celebrate their children well. Guys don't do this so well. You know, but maybe some guys do and stuff, but for the most part, mothers do this well all the time, usually. But moms celebrate their children when they're involved in extracurricular activities. My mom was no exception. She and Dad would sit in the stands and watch me and my brother play sports, and they would hoot and holler with the best of them and celebrate and encourage and support and go to the faraway games and stuff. They just love to celebrate our life. But for mothers, sometimes celebrating is tough. Sometimes when mothers look upon their children, and sometimes the children don't always make the good decisions, and sometimes it's tough to get into a spirit of celebration and to find that joy, right? And Mary was no exception. Mary was familiar with these things. Mary had circumstances which tried to rob her of her celebrating. Tried to rob her of celebrating this specific child. I think that's the plan. If the devil can give you grief, you're not going to celebrate your child. You're going to be more grieving, right? So this is the devil's attempt. I mean, because Mary, as a young lady, is now being told she's going to give birth to the Son of God, right? And it's not like she's going to be able to hide it. And she's in a village of people where at this point in time, you know, you've got ostracized for stuff like this. Disfellowship with. People are walking on the other side of the street and stuff at times like this. This was real issues, real problems for Mary. And these were things that attacked her being able to celebrate this good news. There are times your children don't make good decisions, and it attacks your ability to celebrate their life and their God purpose. And Mary is familiar with this. Mary had all kinds of reasons to celebrate, but we see her saying things or reasons not to celebrate. And we see this in Luke chapter, and we see her attitude though. We see her attitude in Luke chapter 1, verse 46 through 49. And Mary said, my soul, that'll keep in mind, she's a young girl. And Mary said, my soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. She's already known who God is in her life, right? And then she goes on to say, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. For now, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name. Now Mary was ready to celebrate, even in the midst of circumstances which did not call for a celebration. And I think that's the difference between Christian mothers and non-Christian mothers, is that you go to a perfect God with unbearable circumstances, and you're somehow, you're able to find the ability to celebrate because of God's promises and His truths. You're able to find a place of celebration, even in the midst where everybody else is standing out saying, are you crazy? How can you be laughing in a time like this? How can you have a smile in a time like this? You should be crying and weeping in the wall and just, you know, you're the victim. You should be all this and that. But not so much. Not when God's in your life. Not when God's your anchor. Not when God's your chief cornerstone. Not when He says He's a provider. Not when He says He will never leave you nor forsake you. Christian women, Christian mothers should not be people who give up on their celebration. Circumstances in your lives, mothers, may be calling for you. May not be calling for you to celebrate right now, but the little things you do cause your children to see what you've done to love them. The second word I can give you, not only celebration, but the second word is frustration. Sundays could be one of those most frustrating days in your week for mothers. That is, getting your kids ready for church and getting them hustling them out the door, getting them here at church, only to argue with them. You should have been ready at that. I told you last night when you get to bed, I told you when you get up, and I had to get you up and dress you, and I laid out your clothes, and you didn't. You put on the wrong clothes, and you wore your play shoes instead of your good shoes. Bible, and it goes on from there, and it says, that's what I do. And it could be a frustration. It could make out for the frustrating state of the day for you as mothers. After all, maybe you didn't get that phone call from your oldest to appreciate you as a mother. Maybe your mother, if she's still with us today, if you didn't call her and she called you this morning, I didn't get a call from you. And now everything's going haywire. Today, Mother's Day, could be a frustrating day for you and create a frustrating state of mind throughout the rest of the day. And it might leave you thinking some things that are not true. Frustration, if you walk around in it and you wallow in it and you think upon it, it leads you to thinking. I know there's many moms here at Haven's Christian Church. We have kids under the age of 5. And if you're a parent, at some point, that child has frustrated you. Where you break down and you could say or catch yourself saying, even though at the end of the day you know it ain't true, but even though you catch yourself saying, I'm a horrible mother, where did I go wrong? There's been, and there will be a lot of times your kids will do something that just causes you to put your head in your hands and say, I'm a horrible mother. One time, I mean, if there's anybody that can say this, it's my mother. She had 2 twins, and one time, you know, I'm 1 of 4, and me and my twin brother Nate, you know, we decided we was going to do something good for mom. And that's the thought I'd like to leave in your heads as I move on. Is we decided to do something good for mother. As she was sleeping peacefully, me and my brother got up and decided to clean the house. It was a thought. It was a nice thought. Now, we were young, but that, you know, 2 young boys with very creative minds looking for excitement. And there's 2 young boys can only find so much in cleaning. So we got, you know, the old, they still have those brooms, and they're probably the best brooms, but it's the straw brooms, you know. You're just and they're stiff, they're nice, and then they stay together better, but you're sleeping on the floor. And me and Andy was just like, you know, this is gorgeous. There's some way we can make this more tight. So we did. And we got a lighter. And we lit the bottom of the brooms. And let me tell you, it was exciting. We started sweeping, and the coals and stuff, and it was getting, the fire was getting bigger. And we're sweeping, we're thinking, oh Lord, we're going to have to do something about this. Because we both two brooms on fire, and wouldn't you know it, Mom didn't see the appreciation in it at all. She got up to the smell of burning rugs, and immediately started stomping, and immediately saying, what are you thinking? And I can remember Mom crying, as if, what did she do to deserve such challenges in life? Challenges to put them out. But what did she do? And so I couldn't help but to think, a lot of mothers out there probably put their head in their hands and they ask themselves, what did I do wrong? How could I be such a horrible mother? Because if our kids ain't going right, the stinking thinking is that there's something we did wrong. But you know what? I'm going to be real with you. And I don't say this word often, but the truth of the matter was, me and my brother was stupid. We played with fire. And we liked it. And we did some bad things. That was not my brother's fault. That was our fault, right? We're the ones that got up. Not like we had an alarm. Got up and made purposely before Mom did. Our minds was just not very restful. It was constantly at work, so we put it to work and it didn't always work out the way we hoped. From others, let me ask you a heartfelt question. Isn't it true that it's hard for you to separate your kids' failures from your heartfelt frustrations? That you're not frustrated with decisions that they have made? And you start questioning yourself of where you went wrong. I mean, is that not true? Every time you see your child fail, make a bad decision, make a mistake, and you feel like you start having a difficulty not thinking that there's something you did wrong. Frustration can lead to false ideas, is my point. Maybe you should give up. Maybe you was never meant to be a mother. Things like this come into play. And that's not true. Me and my brother made that decision that morning along with others. Not my mother. Not my father. Me. And it was my call. My mom will tell you, every week of her life, while we were young, she would wonder what she did wrong. In school, I wasn't always a good student. I know you have a problem believing in that, but I wasn't always a good student. I knew the principal on a first-name basis. I mean, to tell you, I couldn't get away from this man. I thought harassment, stalking, but I would get in trouble because the teacher had too many rules. I would get in trouble in class, sent to the office, and when you know, there's Jerry Eames waiting. I would assume the position, because back then they still whipped you. I just assumed the position. I think it's harassment and stalking. I think Jerry's problems at home filtered to work and he had to take them out somehow. But I know there were trips to the school where Mom would just white knuckle the steering wheel, you know. God, just keep him out of prison. I'm afraid of him. You know, there had to be thoughts like that. You know, when my grandma would call up, Mary Ann, they're on the roof again. Get them off the roof, they're going to fall. And you know, guys, boys, I'm looking in the chimney, I'm thinking things are fine, I'm running around on the roof, I think things are fine. Do you think Mary ever got frustrated?
Oh, yes.
Can you imagine? I mean, And I'm sorry, I think like this, but I'm just being transparent. I mean, can you imagine being the mother of Jesus at his young age and it's coming to homework time and Mary's trying to tell him, you got that question wrong? And he said, no, I didn't. I mean, he knows, obviously, right? He's the Son of God, right? He's never wrong. And then there's bath time where he's sitting on top of the water instead of in the water. And Mary's trying to push him down, trying to get water. You can't be doing this. And we don't. Now, we can't prove it. You know, that's probably not true. I mean, I can't help it. I think about stuff. You got to wonder. If you do know of one situation, Mary and Joseph, they lived in Galilee, which is some days' journey from Jerusalem. And we knew this journey took anywhere from 3 to 7 days, just depending on how much they wanted to camp out and how much time they wanted to take or add. But during their journey from Galilee to Jerusalem, they would travel in groups. And it was safer to do this because there was bandits and robbers and stuff that would steal and whatnot. And it was just safer to travel in groups, and they would travel in groups. So, specifically, there was a time where they did go to Jerusalem, traveling group, got there to attend a celebration, a ceremony, if you will, and they would, after the celebration, they would pack up and they'd go back to Galilee. And it wasn't uncommon for the children, the village children, if you will, to join up with other kids in the village and play with them. And they would do so in the village and on journeys like this. And so Mary and Joseph would pack up and get ready to go back to Galilee, not seeing Jesus in their presence, assuming that he was with the other kids and playing with the other village kids and in the company of adults and everything. They just assumed this. So into their journey they go, and we see they realize at some point in their journey, some distance away, they realize Jesus is nowhere to be found. And they look around and they start asking the group that they traveled with, hey, where's Jesus? We thought maybe he was he's not with us. We haven't seen him. So now Joseph and Mary, they're spazzing out now. They're like, have you ever forgotten your kid? Don't answer that. But they, you know, they assumed one thing was another. So I was forgotten one time, and I see Taylor like anyway, that's another message. That's a series. Anyway, God taught me a lot on that journey. So Mary and Joseph, I mean, can you imagine their walk back to Jerusalem? I mean, imagine what Mary said to Joseph. Here's your phone. I can't believe you left your husband. And vice versa. And Joseph's like, I thought you had it. And he has no clue, right? And she's like, the closer they get, the more mad she's getting. And Jesus said, I can't believe you just disrespect us like this. And Joseph's all the while thinking, I'm glad she's mad at him and not me. And that's a lot of us, right? And so she's human. So we see in Luke chapter 2, verse 48 to 52, it says, when his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, son, why have you treated us like this? In English language, it's like, what were you thinking? And imagine, we tend to read this subtly. And as a mom, you think Mary was subtle? Oh, yeah. Hey, what were you thinking? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you. Why? And then Jesus said, probably subtly.
Yeah.
Why were you searching for me? As if he didn't know. He asked, didn't you know I had to be in my father's house? But they did not understand, mothers. This was a circumstance that Mary found herself in that she didn't ask for, had no control of necessarily. And yet, she didn't understand it. And as mothers, I think there are times that we don't understand why our kids do what they do. But they didn't understand what they were saying to them, what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them, but his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom, in stature, and in favor with God and man. Notice mom does the screaming while dad here stays silent. That's just, you know it's true now. The Bible's true because it relates to today's society. I mean, that's 9 times out of 10, mom's going to screaming and dad's just glad she's not yelling at him. What are you doing? You know? You ever not understand your kids? I mean, because this is Mary here. She didn't always understand Jesus or the rest. You know, just the other day, I didn't understand something my kid was doing. And kids, I say, Joe specifically, I mow the grass. And I'm just happy to go, like, you know, I like to mow grass and stuff. And I mow the grass and I look over and there's Joe and Noah were working on a burn pile in the garden, just part of some large pieces of wood that we had found here and there in the yard. And they picked up and they put it in there. So they were, evidently Noah sent Joe to get the fuel to start the fire. And also the igniter, the lighter. So, to my surprise, I look over. Just about the time I'm looking over, I'm mowing, mind you. I'm on kind of like a slant. And I look over, and there's Joe with the gas can in his hand, and the lighter about that far away, and he's clicking it. And the flames are going. All I can think in my head is fume, combustion. He don't have the concept of fumes igniting, right? But I'm planning a funeral right now. That's all went through my head. I'm like, oh, dear baby Jesus, do not ever light a lighter. That, not even that part. Don't light a lighter anywhere in the fuel. I'm not doing that. And I said, give this to your brother. I said, and have him handle the fire. So he's like, he just went on. And then another time, we were up on a hill, up on top of the hill, and I had, for whatever reason, I had a blue spray paint can up there, and I was doing something. I didn't forget what I was doing, but I'll never forget what happened. So I'm fiddling around there, and then Joe, I see him playing with this blue spray paint can. And he puts it down on the ground, and I turn around and I do this. I never once done one. But kids love sharp instruments. And Joe likes knives, axes, machetes, you know, stuff that are safe to play with. And he cuts trees down and twigs and everything. He does it all the time. And so this one time, it didn't dawn on me, and he had an axe in his hand. Oh yeah, you know what's coming. And I'm playing, I'm doing something here, and I turn around. About the time I turn around, there's Thor with his axe. And he's getting ready to come down on that can. And I know that can's under pressure.
Right.
All I can think about is blindness. I'm thinking pain in the eyes, blah, blah, blah. And, but I couldn't say it fast enough. The axe was coming down. He came down, and it went poof, like that. It popped. And all I can see is a blue cloud come up on his face. And Joe come up there with the, and he opened his eyes. And the only thing I could see, I mean, he looked like a smurf. And the only thing I could see was his eyes. His eyes wasn't blue. And I couldn't laugh for being mad. He said, oh, my God. And I grabbed him, and I ran down the hill. I said, Lila, put some water in his eyes. And I'm thinking, what kind of pain we got here? Because he didn't know how long he was out with water. And I can't put mural spirits in his eyes. I can't put a solvent in his eyes, right? I'm thinking, oh, my God, we got to go to the doctor. And, but thank God, it didn't hit his eyes, and he's able to get his stuff off. And what a traumatic, I'll never forget that. I never come off that hill so fast. But Joe learned that day, contents under pressure mixed with a puncture item that doesn't mix. He stays away from paint cans now. For the love of God. Sometimes they will do things you don't understand. I asked him, what were you thinking? And sometimes Mary did that. She said, what are you thinking? Sometimes you've done that. What were you thinking? We've all done it. I don't want you to miss this event in Scripture, because moms, maybe you're frustrated with your kids, but I think through all circumstances, God can create good out of bad. And I think it's not that God caused your kids to make bad choices or bad decisions. It's that sometimes we don't understand God's plan as parents, specifically today as a mother. Sometimes we don't understand. Mary didn't, and the Scripture told us this. Sometimes God's in the work and we're unaware. Sometimes, moms, God will do a work in our child's life that you will have no control of, as you'll see. And you'll not understand it. And the only thing you can do as mothers is to trust God. Amen. Truth of the matter is, every mother in here deserves a plaque, a medal, a super mom symbol on your chest. Every mother in here is awesome for what you go through and do and endure. Amen. But the truth of the matter is, in the midst of everything you would like to do and be, God still wants you as mothers to trust in you.
Amen.
He is your creator and you are his creation. There's no one that knows you better than the Father above. Frustration will and may cause you to think false things. So in your frustrations is the time we need to reach for God and trust in Him. Which brings us to our third word. And that is dedication. Celebration, frustration, and now dedication. My mom would come oftentimes to the football games and all the track meets and all the school plays. And mind you, when I say school plays, I'm talking the Christmas plays that would last 3 or 4 hours. And I'm talking how hot it is in the auditorium. You know how limited seating is. You know how cute kids can be and how funny that could be. But laughter only goes so far when there's no air, when you have to sit there and everybody's fanning and everybody's talking. You can't even hear your kid perform. I mean, think about all the things that come into play when you attend your kids' Christmas plays or dance or recitals of sorts. And all this comes into play. So, but there's moms. They're dedicated. They stay there. They come year in and year out. They sit in the stands cold and too hot or whatnot, and they yell. Even when we're doing bad, they yell and support us. And I'm telling you that Jesus, my next point is not trying to tell mothers to be more dedicated, but to tell mothers that there is one that's dedicated to you, and that's Jesus. Sometimes you don't always feel dedicated, but know that Jesus is dedicated to you. When you're going through life, mothers, when you're going through life, life starts happening. You're not always going to get it right. You're not always going to do the right thing. You're not always going to feel like you have it all together. In those moments, you think you're going to lose control. And that's when you need to start reaching and having the faith and trust that God wants you to have. The message today is simple. There's only things mothers can do. God's created mothers and He's created fathers. And those two imitate the Father above. And God has put it upon each and every one of us for specific things. And if you're a single mom out there, bless you. You have to play both parts. And that may have not been God's plan at all for you. But I'm here to tell you, there is one dedicated to you. In your storms of life, God's there for you. If you would, close the Scripture. Now's the time we need to get into a spirit of meditation, a spirit of thought. I've given you a few words. I've given you some scriptures about how a mother was challenged as you were challenged today. And now it's time for the application of this. I ask you to stand with me. In the Bible, Jesus is on the cross. He's about to die. Mary is present, and she's watching all this go down. Ask yourself as a mother, if you saw your child on the cross, what would be going through your mind? Maybe she was She's telling herself how she wasn't in control of this, but she wished she was. Maybe she was telling herself that if she only had more political pull, that she could have averted Jesus from going to the cross. Maybe there was something she could have done, a plea that she could have made. Maybe she was just thinking all the failures of her life. Maybe she was thinking how horrible of a mother she was while her son was fighting for his life. But when Jesus saw his mother in the midst of the screaming, in the midst of those walking by and mocking the Son of God, as Jesus saw his mother, he sees her. And while he was making arrangements for you and my sins, he paused to pay attention to his mother. And he says this in John chapter 19. He says, it was near the cross of Jesus stood his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother there and his disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her in as his own, into his home. Jesus saw his mother. He saw her pain. He saw her hurt. He saw her questions. He saw her fear. He saw her doubt. He saw her anxieties. I mean, think about it. Be a Mary for a minute. Your child is on the cross. Maybe you felt like a bad mother this week. Maybe you felt doubt. Maybe you felt fear, anxiety, not understanding what your child maybe made a bad decision. You don't know how the future is going to turn out. But we ask that you don't. God said, "Don't leave me out of this. I'm dedicated to you. I put the dedication you have in your heart to your children. I put that in there. I'm dedicated to you." And I know that I know that I know your little acts of compassion, your prayers, are making a difference for my mom years ago, 41 years and 9 months ago, made a declaration while we were in her womb that these children in her womb will be serving God. And today, me and my brother both do. And my mom knew and stayed firm and believed in the Creator that we were going to come full circle with the Lord. And she prayed and she prayed, even in the midst of burning rugs, walking on roofs, falling out of trees, doing what boys do, uncertain of our future, praying and pleased to keep us out of prison. And uncertain, she still prayed. Still kept the walk alive. I stand here today because of those acts of kindness that often people don't hear. Acts of compassion, faithful to prayer. I stand here today because of that. Today, I see Lila doing the same thing. Praying for her children. Being dedicated to her children. Celebrating her children. Being frustrated with her children. I see all of this today. All mothers around her, you're no different. You're created in God's image and created to be those things. God would have you to say that I'm dedicated to you. I am here for you. When life doesn't make sense, I am here for you. You're impacting the life, mothers. Don't fall to the thought process that you're a failure. Where did you go wrong? Maybe it's not meant for you to be a mother. That's not true. But you are a mother. God created you for a time such as this. And it's because of your dedication that your child will succeed. Your prayers. God is not deaf to your prayers. For the Bible says, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground without the Father's care." But if God would care for such as these, how much more will God care for you? You are worth more than a sparrow. His eyes today are on mothers everywhere. I ask you, if you do not come to the altar for a special need of prayer, in your pews, during this next song, lift up mothers in prayer. If you're a mother here today, pray that God will keep you steadfast on the path that you're on and trust in Him. That you don't have to be a super mom and bear all the burden that He wants to take from you. Maybe that's your prayer in your pews for. Let the truth of God's love keep moving you and build your children. Amen?
Has overcome, and the grave is
you leave, after the next song when you leave, there's purple flowers out there for the mothers. Please grab one and on your way out. Also, there's cookies and cupcakes out there for you mothers and celebrating Mother's Day today. Grab one on your way out. If you don't need it now, save it for later. But those things have been put together for you. I just want to also give a special thanks out to Leslie Brown and Marianne Harmon and those who donated to Mother's Day tea yesterday, our first Mother's Day tea. There was plenty of people come out for that. Everybody had a good time. And I just wanted to encourage next year, we're going to do some things. And I just want to encourage you to come out for that. What an awesome time that was. And also, we're going to continue our conversations with God next week with Pastor Rick as we learn about prayer. So please come out for that.
Authority to overcome.
Amen.
Amen. Have a great one. Have a great one.